online, on digital radio and TV, and on 94.9 FM.
London's radio station.
BBC Radio London.
Good morning, I'm Alex Bushill, standing in for Robert Elms this morning. As you know, and as many of your legion of his fans know, he's in Iceland, so it's me to take the hot seat. So I hope you enjoy the next hour with me. Now, it is Monday, so as always, we'll have a listed Londoner answering the famous 15 questions that Robert always puts at this time of the morning. This week, it's Pete Bellotte. He's in the hot seat today. As disco fans amongst you will know, he is a legend. The boy from Barnet who went to release and record absolutely classic songs with the likes of Giorgio Moroder, Donna Summer, Three Degrees, Janet Jackson and Elton John. We'll be hearing from some of those artists in the next hour. He's also, though, and a lot of you won't know this, I certainly didn't, he's also a prose writer and has an excellent new book out called The UNROUND CIRCLE. We'll be hearing a lot more about that in the next few minutes. It is a collection of 22 short stories exploring the range of behaviour that people are capable of. Intriguing, isn't it? First, what better to get the show kicked off with than one of the great tunes that Pete Bellotte was associated with? He wrote it and produced it, and it is, of course, Donna Summer, Hot Stuff. There you have it, Donna Summer, Hot Stuff, and I'm very privileged to say that Pete Bellotte joins me now in the studio. Thank you for coming on the programme, Pete.
It's a pleasure, Alex.
That was probably, arguably, your greatest hit by Donna Summer. Is that how you see it?
Oh, it certainly is. It's been the biggest seller and the most radio-played song of all.
You must be sick of hearing it, though, maybe.
Oh, no, no, I love it. I still love it.
Just remind me then, you were born in Barnet. How did you first get into disco then? Because just paint me a scene of that time in your life. It was the early 70s.
At that point, I was in Germany, living in Munich. I teamed up with Giorgio Moroder probably 2 or 3 years before disco actually started. So we've been recording for quite a while.
And how did you meet him then?
I met him through a photographer friend of mine who worked for a magazine. So it was one of those serendipity moments.
And just talk me through that moment then where you were at a party together. At what point did you actually meet? How did you know that there was a connection straight away? Because he was, to prove, your most important collaborator, wasn't he?
Oh, yes, yeah, yeah. I was in Munich trying to find my way into the music scene there because I'd just finished with my band and I decided that I was going to be a record producer because I knew that was the best job. And a friend of mine said he just met Giorgio Moroder and he's looking for someone to work with. So I went along to meet him and it was a great experience. I had this huge long moustache at the time and I thought, because Germany was quite conservative there, and I thought, perhaps I'll shave that off. And when I went along to meet Giorgio, he had this huge long moustache. So.
So you connected for that reason, if yeah. no other. And how soon did you learn that you both had the same taste in music? You wanted to do the same thing? Because back then, disco hadn't really kicked off. It was very much, pioneering
yeah.
moment.
Oh, absolutely. We were doing kind of pop music at the time. In fact, one of the first songs that we had together was a song called Son of My Father, which was a number one in England. And that was probably a year and a half before Donna Summer, really. But the disco thing came about. It was just one of those flukes. We had this song, Love to Love Your Baby. And when we used to record, we had a set of musicians who were always there with us. So there were keyboards, drums, guitar and bass. And when they used to warm up, they used to warm up with whatever their favourite bit of music was at the time. And there was a Crusaders track from the year before. I think it's called Candy something, and it had in the middle section of it at the bass drum doing the four on the floor, the boom 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 boom. It sounds strange now, but that was absolutely revolutionary to hear a drummer do that on the floor. So when they were warming up, the drummer used to do that, and he also used to copy the Hughes Corporation Rock Your Boat hi-hat, which we called later the pea suit because it went pss, 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 pss. And so they were combining this in the warm-up for the song. So we thought we'd take that element without any idea that it was going to be a disco kind of thing.
And use that as the bedrock for,
yes,
for the sound that you then forged with Giorgio.
Exactly, yeah. And then the song came out in England with Dick Lee Records, GTO Records, and didn't do a thing. And a year later, Casablanca in America took the record, Neil Bogart. He had it released as a single, but he phoned us on a Friday night because he was having this sort of party. It was one of those sort of getting it on parties, I guess. And he said, we have to keep putting the record on all the time because it's only 3 minutes. So could you make a full-sided recording of it, like Iron Butterfly's In a Garda de Vida? So within a week, we had redone the album and it was a 17-minute song. And then it just burst onto the disco scene in New York.
And the rest, as they say, is history.
It's history, yeah. So it was just lucky.
And let's listen to another band that you've had a great relationship with, The Three Degrees, and their song. Now let's hear Giving Up, Giving In.
You flew out.
What was that song?
Thank you.
Of course it was. Okay, that was Giving Up, Giving In by The 3 Degrees, one of Pete Bellotti's many, many hits. You have worked with Giorgio Moroder, we discussed as writer and producer up until the 80s. You worked with a legion of stars, including Elton John, Donna Summer. First of all, though, just Pete, talk me through a little bit what it was like being in Munich and then, you know, going through the 70s, the kind of those great moments that we all associate with disco, from the Studio 54 to some of the artists that you worked with. You've just told me while we were listening to that song that you're pretty abstinence yourself. You didn't drink a great deal. And yet you saw such excess and such hedonism synonymous with that period.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, there was, with the record company in the States, Neil Bogart's record company, there was never a budget. You could spend whatever you want. You commuted by Concorde. You never had to ask for money. You just spent it. And Casablanca, the building, it was just an offices of excess, to say the least. You know, there was a lot
Just remind our viewers where Casablanca, the building, was.
Casablanca was on Sunset in L.A., and Neil Bogart's office was Casablanca in the film. It was exactly like Humphrey Bogart's old place.
Quite intimidating going in there, I imagine. Or a lot of fun.
Oh, it was okay. I mean, everyone was friendly, but they were all sort of, a lot of them were out of their heads, to say the least. The money was, just to give an example, when Love to Love You launch party came along, that was to be held in New York. Neil Bogart was in LA. He had the cake made in San Francisco because he liked the bakery out there. It was flown first class in a first class seat down to LA, flown in a first class seat with a minder to New York, where it was met with an ambulance with a red light flashing away. Obviously, the press were there, and it was taken to the venue there for the big launch party. So,
thank goodness no one sat on it or dropped it.
So that was just for a cake.
Wow. And just talk me through then some of the artists you've worked with. We've heard already Donna Summer this morning played the first song that we listened to. Who do you remember with the greatest fondness? Because it must have been so difficult at that time of excess to keep your feet on the ground. Clearly you did. Clearly from the interviews I've heard of Giorgio Moroder, he did to a degree as well. But
but
it must have been very difficult not to let, you know, your ego get carried away with you.
No.
Particularly with the level of fame and success that you were enjoying as well.
I don't think we ever had ego in that sense.
Some of the artists you work with,
a lot of people did.
Though.
I always remember getting in the lift once. The Village People producer was in the lift. I knew who he was, but I didn't speak or anything. And he suddenly said to me, "Do you realize who I am?" I said, "No." He said, "I am Jacques Morales, the Village People producer." And then he got out of the lift, you know, so... He was quite proud.
You didn't have a moment like that yourself?
No.
I'm sure not.
I've always stayed out of the limelight.
And just to talk me through then, in terms of the artists you've worked with, who was the one that you found the most inspiring as an artist?
I think that all great musicians are inspiring. Donna was exceptional because she was a one-take artist. It was her habit to come in the studio to record a song that she had only just briefly heard. And then she would talk, because Donna loved talking. Then after about an hour and a half of talking, she'd look at her watch and say, "Oh, I've got to go, I've got to go." And she'd sing the song in one take. And that was how she was. She was just a one-take artist. But, you know, whether it was Shalimar or Elton, or everyone is nice, really.
And the list of artists that we've discussed show the range of your work. You also wrote for films, and one of the most famous films of all time, certainly a personal favourite of mine, Scarface. Let's hear one of your tunes now, Push It to the Limit, from that film, performed by Paul Engerman and written by yourself.
Stop you, there's nothing that's wrong. So close now, you're nearly at the brink. So safe while you're still living. Welcome to the limit. Standing on the razor's edge. So don't look down, just keep your head or you'll be finished.
Well, you were just listening to one of Pete's many great tunes, including that one there for the film Scarface. Well, after the news, my guest, Pete, will be answering the famous 15 questions that I know Robert Elms poses on a Monday morning. My listed Londoner this morning is the record producer, songwriter and prose writer, Pete Bellotte, who we've been chatting away already for some time, and fabulous it has been too. We'll hear about his new book, The Unround Circle, a little bit later on. But first, let's get straight into the first listed Londoner question. Now, Pete, what is... Now, I know you're a Barnet boy originally, but what is your favourite neighbourhood?
Okay, Alex, I'm going to choose Soho, that little pocket of eccentricity. And I always like to refer to it as the living metaphor of the fictional Jekyll and Hyde, which was also set in Soho. And I've known it since the 60s, because when I was a 15-year-old boy, I went down to the Two Eyes Coffee Bar, which was in Soho, in Old Compton Street. And it was the kind of the mecca of the rock and roll world then. So it was upstairs, it was a coffee bar, and downstairs, a narrow flight of stairs, you came into this cellar, and it was a very dark cellar with a low ceiling and a tiny stage, and the band used to play down there, and you could get up and sing with them if they were friendly enough to let you go up. So I approached them, and they allowed me to get up on stage as a 15-year-old kid, and I sung a Jerry Lee Lewis song called Down the Line. And I came off afterwards and I felt really good. And I went over to my friend and I said, how was it? And he said, I couldn't hear you above the music. So it was a bit disappointing.
What a missed opportunity, particularly is what you were going to go on to achieve. What, just very briefly, what do you make of the Soho now with the arguments about gentrification? It's an area I know and I'm hugely fond of as well.
Well, everyone says Soho's changing. Or changed, but everywhere has changed, you know. But it still combines that seediness and sumptuousness, I think, and I love it. It's a great place.
Okay, well, let's ask the next question then. What is your favourite building in our great city then, Pete?
Okay, London's, of course, full of most diverse and wonderful buildings in the world, really, but I'm going to choose a neo-Georgian townhouse with the concomitant uniformity and symmetry of a townhouse. And it's going to be number 3 Abbey Road, which was once EMI Studios, but it's now Abbey Road Studios. The facade's been simplified, but it's still an elegant building. But I've chosen it, of course, because...
You recorded there, didn't you?
With my band, we recorded 5 singles there for Columbia. And in those days, for an A and a B side, you had 3 hours to record 2 songs, to mix them and master them in that time. But as a treat, because you had to be a member of the Musicians Union, you got paid as well. So you got paid to record. So it was fun.
It's a beautiful building. And of course, to use that very overused word, iconic. Let's go down to the other end of the spectrum. Your most hated building then, Pete.
Okay, right. It is being touched up a bit now. So it's kind of lost the edge of my dislike, but I still dislike it. It's the Shell building. When you're coming out of Waterloo there, it's an awful 60s edifice. And despite the Portland stone cladding, it still looks like dull concrete to me. And I think for a visitor coming out of the Waterloo to go to the London Eye for the first time, I think, oh, what a disappointing entrance.
I suppose the joy of being in the Shell building is that you're not looking at it, you're looking out over the river and the beautiful views of the river. What is your favourite view then in London?
That would have to be at the Tate Modern in the restaurant. I just love that view. And you get the juxtaposition of the old St. Paul's and the new Millennium Bridge and the band of river with all the river traffic going along in both directions. It's just a lovely, lovely view. I could sit there for hours.
And your favourite open space then, Pete? There are lots of new ones. There's the new square in King's Cross, but maybe it's an old one that's taken your fancy.
Yeah, there are... lots of open space, and London is a spoil for parks as well. And I always love to think that Hyde Park and Kensington Garden combined larger than Monaco, but I'm going for another park and I'm going to choose Greenwich because I just love the spaciousness there, the openness, and the views are incredible. And there's the unique view that you're looking from the observatory of Wren to St. Paul's of Wren. So you're looking from Wren to Wren, which I think is a wonderful thing.
Even in the summer with all the tourists, I just live up the road from there. And I have to say, in the summer, it can get pretty difficult to move around there.
Yeah, you choose your moments.
Quite very good advice. Well, let's get some music now. Perhaps the greatest disco tune of all time. This is I Feel Love by Donna Summer. Well, that was I Feel Love by Donna Summer, clearly one of the most influential songs, Pete, that you had the privilege to write and produce. Let's carry on with the 15 questions. I'm not sure if you're a big shopper, but let's ask you what your most interesting shop is anyway.
Well, it's going to have to be a bookshop. I'm going to go into Cecil Court, you know, between Charing Cross Road and St. Martin's, where the young 8-year-old Mozart lived for a few months. And I'm going to choose Peter Ellis's bookshop. He specializes in modern first editions and illustrated books. So drop me off there first thing in the morning and pick me up when it closes.
And you'll have had a great day, I can guarantee it. Certainly from the smile on your face, that's for sure. And what about your favorite bar, pub or restaurant, then?
Okay.
Are we going to Soho again? Or?
No, we're off to South Moulton Street. We're going to Brasserie Max at the Covent Garden Hotel. A thing that my wife and I do, Ellie, we go there on the weekend sometimes, and I have my favourite meal of the day. I have a breakfast, and she sits opposite me and has lunch, because brunch and lunch overlap there. So that's something I love to do.
So an unusual way to have brunch.
Yeah.
And without giving away any confidences, please tell me what your most memorable night out in London has been. We're talking to a disco king here, aren't we, Pete? So how hedonistic
No,
does it get?
It's a very humble, quiet experience. When I'd originally turned 40, I had a paradigm shift, and I thought I was aging too fast, and I hated the idea of any celebrations. And then my 50th came, and so I said to Ellie, let's just go and have a pizza in Fulham. And as we walked along there, she suddenly pushed me into the Blue Elephant, which I had no idea about. And there was a huge, large round table there. And all my friends were waiting there for me. And we just had this wonderful night. And Ellie even smuggled in a cake from my favourite Italian deli. And it may not sound much, but it just means so much to me.
Oh, it sounds fantastic. Yeah. I've just had my 40th. Something similar for me. And it's a bit of a cliche, but somehow it just gets straight to you, doesn't it?
It does.
Yeah.
Well, you know, looking back now, it's fine now. You're over that.
Yes, I am. And what about, how would you like to spend your ideal day off then in London? We've had a day in the bookshop. Anywhere else?
Okay, now this is an easy one. I'd like to be blindfolded, driven willy-nilly somewhere within an 8-mile radius of Piccadilly.
This is an easy one. This sounds very intriguing.
You take off the blindfold, and then I walk my way back very casually, carrying London's Blue Guide for reference. And I'm sure that on the way there'll be all kinds of surprises, hopefully nice ones.
I never understand why people take the tube so religiously for that exact reason. It is the most wonderful city for getting lost in.
We only ever walk.
Yeah.
I never go by tube or taxi or anything.
And I imagine you still find places that you hadn't known were there.
I mean, London is just such an impressively exciting city.
Well, I know that the next question that Robert would ask you is, where would you take someone visiting from out of town? And I hope you wouldn't blindfold them and take them somewhere unknown.
This is easy because it's a visitor has to be taken to the obvious. So starting off at the Eye, I'd point out the 32 pods, meaning the 32 boroughs of London. And then
I didn't even know that.
Oh, there you go. And then I'd take them to Trafalgar Square via the Houses of Parliament and Westminster, seats of power. Then through Admiralty Arch, along the Mall, to Buckingham Palace, seat of sovereign power. Then to Green Park and off to the Wolseley, and where I hope I can point out a couple of celebs. Then to Horse Guards Parade and Downing Street, the seat of too much power. Then Westminster Pier, get on a boat, off to the Tower, watch a few executions. Then get on the boat again, down to Greenwich, have a nice look around Greenwich. Then get on the Docklands Light Railway, off to Canary Wharf. Look at the lovely Norman Foster Station, get on the tube, off to Covent Garden, have a pizza outside and watch the street entertainers. Then we're ready for the theatre, so we go to Sam Wanamaker's Playhouse, and it doesn't matter what's playing because it's the candlelight theatre of the world. And finally, just to top it all off, we'd have a drink outside on the top of the Oxo Tower.
I think you'd need it. That's a very long day. Sounds great fun, though. Let's turn it on its head, then. The worst journey that you've had to take in London.
The worst journey? Well, I'm going to have to precede this very quickly because it can't be a traffic thing because we all face traffic. But it was in 1973. I was sitting in the back of a Mini. Elton John was in the passenger seat. John Reed was driving, and we were coming down the road, and suddenly a car pulled out from the right. It didn't hit us, but it was a big blue Zodiac. And I thought, oh my goodness. John Reed then wound down the window. He was Elton's manager, and he fired off these expletives at this man, and suddenly we were being chased down the road by this Zodiac, and we were up on the pavement all over the place, and we finally got down to the bottom of the road, and we were trapped by the traffic lights because it was a two-way street in those days. The guy got out, and I said, he's coming, and so John Reed locked the door, the guy turned out to be a giant. He just pulled the door open because he was stronger than the door. And he rained all these blows down on John Reed. There was blood everywhere.
Dear.
And went round to have a go at Elton. But Elton sort of calmed him down then. And so we got John Reed into the passenger seat. And now we were all covered in blood and got him to the hospital. And he was okay, though. It was just blood and bruises. But that was definitely the worst journey in London.
I can see why. And what about when you're, I know you've travelled the world, you've been talked about already a bit about Germany, about LA. At what point do you know that you're back home? What landmarks, signals that this is London and you're where you belong?
Well, yeah, I thought about that question. It depends which way you're coming in, really. Flying in, it would always have to have been Gillette Corner on the Great West Road. But if I was coming by train, it was just that glimpse of the Houses of Parliament. Or if I'm driving in, once again, it's just a glimpse. It's the Hammersmith Apollo.
Oh, right, yeah. Of course. That's a route I come in a great deal, but as well. And when you go up the West Way as well, that for some reason always makes me feel like I'm back.
Yes, exactly.
Back in my orbit.
Yeah, yeah.
And what about your favourite fictional Londoner then? A lot to choose from there.
There are lots of choices, but it's going to have to be Ebenezer Scrooge. He's terrified and fascinated me as a kid. And when I was 9, my uncle bought me the book, A Christmas Carol. I still have it. And by the age of 11, I'd read all of Dickens' novels. That's what an impression he made on me. And the one thing I'd always like to say is everyone says Moby Dick has the best opening of any book, Call Me Ishmael. Mm. But think of this. Marley was dead to begin with. I mean, what an opening. It makes you think of so many things.
Doesn't it? It's very intriguing. It takes you right in there straight away. Well, you've talked about Dickens there. A lot of those have been film adaptations. What is your favourite London film book or documentary then?
My favourite book would have to be Anthony Powell's Dance to the Music of Time. It's 12 volumes and it runs from the 1920s right through to the 70s. Hundreds of characters, but there are probably 20 main characters who just keep appearing and disappearing all the time. It evokes London absolutely wonderfully. It's just a beautifully written book.
Sadly, we seem to have whipped through those 15 questions. We're on the last one now. And if you could travel back to any time period in London, past or indeed the future, where would you go? And you are allowed to choose the 70s.
I'm going to 1930.
1930?
Yes, and I want to be in London around Soho again because of Dylan Thomas and all this sort of people, because I want to meet Mervyn Peake. Because I'm a collector of Mervyn Peake. Uh-huh. I've got probably one of the largest collections of all of his paintings and drawings and books and everything. And I've got so many unanswered questions that I need to pose.
Well, we'll come on to your own writing career in a moment and your new book after one more track. Let's hear a final tune. That's with my having listened to my guest, Pete Bellotte. This is Fruits of the Night by Tina Turner.
Thank you.
Well, that was Tina Turner, Fruits of the Night, written and produced by my guest, who I'm very honoured to join me this morning on the Robert Elms Show, Pete Bellotte. Pete, we've heard so many great stories about your time in disco, and of course the 15 questions there about your memories and thoughts of London. Fascinating stuff, lovely stuff. Let's talk a little bit now about your new book, The Unround Circle. We've heard there about your love of books, clearly, and your love of first lines of books. Just talk us through this collection, then. It's a collection of short stories. Is this your first foray into writing?
Yeah, it's my first published. I've sort of written and jotted things down all my life because I just love writing as I love reading. And I've written a couple of novels that I never tried to get published. I'd written these 22 stories and a publisher heard about it and read it, loved it, and wanted to bring it out straight away. So it was effortless.
That's a fantastic start, clearly. What about the inspiration? Is there an inspiration that binds them all together, or is it a loose collection of witty and...
They're absolutely diverse. They're all very different stories, and there's no link running through anything.
You say that, but I know that the majority are based on London. Is that the case?
Most of them are set in London. One is called 1743, and that is set in 1743 in the age of Handel. And then we come up to today, and there's the rogue Johnny Warmglow, who's a terrible rock and roll manager who fleeces everyone, but he never manages to keep the money himself.
Based on anyone you knew?
No. Perhaps my father? No.
And just talk me through about the process by which you set about writing these short stories. You spoke very eloquently a moment ago about the first line of Christmas Carol. That's the point that you begin, which sounds kind of intuitively right, but probably very difficult. So just talk me through how you wrote each of these short stories.
Well, that's generally what happens. I think up a line or a title. I don't actually think it up. It just comes into my head. Like, for example, 1743, I was walking through the woods one morning and into my head came "My brother was an only child." And I thought, what does that mean? And I went home and I started writing, and a few days later I'd finished the story. And I never know where the stories are going. I just start off and I enjoy it as much as a reader would, because I just don't know what's going to happen.
I've heard so many writers talk about how they know that they're onto something great when it just literally comes out of them in one sitting almost. Is that how you felt with the short stories that you were most proud of? Or did they all literally flow through your fingertips
I never have difficulties writing them. I mean, sometimes I'll write something and after a few pages I perhaps will abandon it because I don't like it, or I think it's going to be too long. I just find it an easy process. I love it.
I look forward to reading your book. Thank you so much for joining me this morning. It's been an absolute pleasure listening to you.
Thank you,
Alex. Talk about your memories, Pete.
It's been a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Very glad to hear it. Well, that's pretty much it from me. Thank you very much to my listed Londoner, Pete Bellotte. His book, The Unround Circle, is out now.